All right, so with the budget reading here now, the conversation has been which sectors are the winners and which are the losers. And I recently had a conversation with the Executive Director of the International Bureau of Standards, David DeBiro, on the impact of underfunding UNBS in relation to the general economic growth. Now, I tell you what, whereas people would say, well, it's an agency that only works on standards, I just learned one thing, that if standards fail, then almost everything that is produced in Uganda, it doesn't matter whether it's the Buy Uganda Bill, Uganda Police, or any other product that is locally produced, will not only be consumed by Ugandans, but also won't be able to be exported across the region or internationally. Okay? So the conversation was, look, we make 60,000 or thereabout out of the collections we make. Is it okay for the government to give us that money and we use it without taking it back to Ministry of Finance and then they apportion part of that money for us? The interesting part, though, is that the budget for UNBS has been dropping over the years from over 68 billion, I'm talking about the last 5 years now, to the recent being 48, and luckily enough, this time they have about, what, 60 billion. Hopefully, it can cause a difference. Plus, understaffing, he says, whereas they do all these borders across the country, they only have 5,000 staff. I'm sorry, 500 staff. And that is compared to URA's over 3,000 staff. Of course, you tell me URA makes more money, but look, the guys, these guys of UNBS handle standards. So maybe we need to increase the number of people that work under there so they can ensure that standards are directly or clearly followed in this country. Plus, a conversation from CSOs on how poor standards of foods that are produced and exported could impact on the trade. There's a lot more to talk about in the world of business. My name is Simon. Thank you so much for joining us on the Business Show this week. From where we're watching, we're glad you could make time. This is what is coming up on the show this week.
You young people are very educated, but you look at your father's business or your mother's business, you despise it. You despise it, you are not interested, you are running around doing some little job in town. Whereas this business has already maybe educated you, however small it was.
All right, welcome to the show. So I'm not very certain of what you're doing with your business, but if it is making money, keep making the money. Don't follow up with the concerns that everyone is raising of how times are hard. Some people are actually making money. You just need to strategize yourself well and see how you can win the next client passing by. Talking clients, let's talk you then through views from the top. And a renowned entrepreneur, we are talking a business consultant and a doctor. This is Dr. Margaret Chigozi, who, if you are in the business space, she needs no introduction. This week, though, we caught up with her to talk about supporting women in business, from the issue of financing to family, and she also gives tips on how you as the children should learn to work in family business, or instead of complaining and saying this is a family business, she says some of these businesses have taught or educated some of you. So it's important that you take part in. And even when you work in those businesses, you need to still remain professional in your operations. This is Views from the Top with Dr. Margaret Chigozi.
We've come a long way. Yeah, we hardly had any women at all when I started. Of course, this was about 20 years ago. There were no women in business. They were just in the markets, a few in trade, the shops. Now we have big businesses. So yes, we have come a long way. And it was a lot of effort, both from the side of the women, from the side of government, and also our associations, like Private Sector Foundation, UMA, supporting the business women. A large number of milestones. I think the biggest one, which has made a difference to more women than anything else, is the free education, the UPE, the USE, and even up to university. So we have many, many more girls who are educated, which was never there in the past. So that has been a major achievement. Secondly, there's a lot of skilling that's ongoing, DIT and vocational colleges all over the place. So people have been able to get skills. Also, our researchers have done very good research for us, especially in the agriculture sector. You have Naro and others in fish, in whatever sector. Dairy has been brilliant. So there's been a lot of research such that when the women are going into these business, so if you're going in agriculture, you need a lot of information, and that is now available. We have district officers, district veterinary officer, district agriculture officer. So you can actually approach somebody at the district level, but also Naro and others, their New Vision and Monitor, they do brilliant agricultural events, you know, that we all benefit from. I go as well, and every time I learn something new. So that information, accessibility, both on social media, but also the newspapers and the radios, has really helped, has been a big opener for women in business. Before, we didn't know anything. Everything was hidden. Nobody knew what I need to do, but now I know, we all know. And also want to thank the women who have especially gone out to train, to encourage, to mentor fellow women. That has happened. It is good that we are now educated, so women, and we have not been leaving things and saying that is a man's course anymore. You see the women in engineering, in ICT, we are there. And that is making a big difference. So when you look at, for example, petroleum, you will find that, you know, the chair is a woman, the Petroleum Authority, the PS is a woman, the minister is a woman. So, you know, and when you have people like that, they also help to be role models for the other women. So these new sectors, the creative industry is a big one. Our musicians, the Winnie Nwajis, the Shebas, we're there, and they're doing very, very well. Of course, the whole sector is still struggling. Copyright, although the necessary laws. Yesterday we had a brilliant film festival. Did you see that? Yes, brilliant film festival. Yes, the creative industry, the film industry, ICT, coding, there's been a special focus on women, on girls, even girls. You see all these programs in all the various, either government or private sector or NGOs, there's a special focus on girls because these are the kinds of businesses that are easy for us. Yes, I have my children, but I can do things at home. I can develop my songs at home and then go and produce, you know, or my film. So there's a lot of work that can be done in these sectors, so they're very good for the women. Plus, now that they have been trained, they know and they're doing very well. I think we took over the marketplaces during the insecure times of Uganda. It was insecure for a man to be in a shop. So the wife was then in the shop. He was there in the background, you know, getting the things to sell and all that. But she was the one, the visible face, the one whom the army maybe, you hope, would not beat her, would not take all her things. So the women took over the marketplace and the small shops around during that time. And now when there is security, they have been able to then grow their businesses and then also diversify into other bigger things. But I see it is a good start for all of us as women. We start small. None of us have the capital to really start something very big. So yes, they do start in, you know, in the marketplace. They do start in shops. They do start growing crops on small acreages. Then as they make money, as they learn how to do business and they get opportunities, they are able to move on and grow. And that is really happening, so it's good. The men, of course, are back. They are also in the shops. They are back in the market also because they are, you know, they're safe. Security is one thing that we have had to a certain extent. during these maybe last 20 years. But before that, it was a problem, which is why women got the opportunity to go into business at all. When I first did a survey, when I was an executive director of the Uganda Investment Authority, we did our very first survey on business women with the IMF. And the one thing that they repeated over and over again, we have no access to finance. We have no access to assets like land. They didn't, because traditionally our culture, the boy inherited the property, and for you, you did not. So that was a major problem. But over the years, they have been able to work in bigger companies. They have jobs, so they've been able to make their own money. And they have been able to inherit. I inherited land. My father gave me a house. My father gave me land. And I've been able to do agriculture on it. And as I have other women, we are now being considered when the family is sharing out the property, which is good. But we needed to work on this. It wasn't easy. Then we came to when you need to go to a bank to borrow money, they will ask you for collateral. That was a big problem. The women did not own land. They did not have any ownership in the house, for example. But the laws have changed along the way. We now own a percentage of the house, the family house, and you can use that. You can use that to borrow. And also, we are able to buy our own land. Land, you can buy it. We used to think we could only inherit land, but we've encouraged the women, if you know, you cannot inherit, your father is not giving you something, you buy your own piece of land, and they are doing that. So they are now able to go to banks, and the banks really want to support women so much. The spirit is there. Many of the women are now headed by women. Some of the biggest, you know, Stanbic, the Citibank. Many banks are headed by women, and they really want to support fellow women. So there are very many programs, almost in all the banks, you know, for women to help them get access to finance more cheaply. And there are programs in UDB, there are programs actually, I must say, in almost all banks that are just for us as women. Of course, the interest rate I think yesterday, one of the ladies talked about 10% annually, a year. Okay, compared to others, it is much lower, but it is still high. It is still not easy for you to make 10% of the business and pay it to the bank, but at least we have made progress. So they have also tried to help us to learn how to do business. There are very many programs, NSSF, all the banks, you know, the business women, they're all training us on how to run a business. That is critical. You don't know how to handle your money. You are not literate, you know, you have no financial literacy. You cannot run a business. So between all those things that I've talked about, we are moving. The women are doing business, growing their businesses, and it's an exciting time. It is still not easy to get money, but if you know how to handle money, you can still grow your business.
You know, I've known Maggie for quite a while now, and for the times I've interviewed her, one thing is for sure, very passionate about business, very passionate about women in business as well, and she will do anything. She is one person that will tell you, I will give you that interview about women in business or anything business, and she will try and be there. And even when she can't make it, she'll let you know, look, these are the kind of people that we need. And maybe that is the kind of consistency that you need in your business. How many times do you tell people you will deliver something on time and you don't? How many times do you say, I will meet the quality, the quantity that you want when I supply and you don't? These are some of the nitty-gritties that you need to pay attention to, because at the end of the day, they affect your output. Because me, as a consumer, if you are not able to meet the demands that I want on time, then I'm going to start questioning how you operate. And maybe I'll just start thinking otherwise and finding the next person that can do the same thing that you're doing or even does it better. You're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Time now for a quick break on the program. In the meantime, stay with us and just keep dropping the comments on our social media handles. Let us know where you're watching from or what is inspiring about the business. What is that thing that you're learning on The Business Show that is helping your business grow? I'll see you shortly.